everybody. Hey, welcome to the show. This is the second show I've done today, and I have to tell you, not the last conversation I've had about what I'm going to have a conversation about. To open the show, welcome to Film Festival Live. In addition, Newsblaze out of Australia, international news and information. But the fact of the matter is that I'm going to take this person, put them there. This is the first time I've done a live stream with a lot of people. I mean, there are, I've got a, like, I'm going to call it a panel of people. Anyway, panel of people that are going to talk about basically on-set safety and potentially maybe the surrounding situation that happened in New Mexico with the Alec Baldwin Rust production and the accident. So I wanted to do this because I got to tell you how many times this weekend I have gotten people reaching out from media to, social media people saying, hey, how could this be? What could that be? How's this go? What is that? How does that work? And I've determined that there's a lot of misconception about what we do in the industry. And, you know, my gun friends are saying, well, you never point a gun at someone. And my film and TV people are saying they don't understand. And there's, again, a lot of misconceptions. So the idea of this program today, which, by the way, if you're looking at Film Festival Live, newsblaze.com, Facebook, you'll see it there. It's on YouTube. We're all over the place. And I'm going to bring in some very important, wonderful people that I've known for a long time that I would say specifically understand the workings of perhaps this gun, which is a single action revolver. That is the type of gun that you use a lot in Westerns, and some other things. I hopefully will have a martial arts person later on in the show talking about that safety part, stunt slash martial arts. I also have a union rep that I, a delegate that I know, Kevin E. West, who's been on the show before. I'm going to try to orchestrate this and do the best I can. So bear with me. If you have comments, suggestions, or whatever, you have questions, you can type them in wherever you're at. And in most cases, I think we'll see them. If you're on Instagram right now watching me, you need to hit my my profile link. If you're watching this right now, the big stream is on one of my Facebooks or whatever. So click on the profile link to watch this amazing conversation I know we're going to have. So the first person I'm going to kind of talk to you about is a director that I've worked with a few times, and they've all been on, I guess you could call Soldier's Revenge a Western, but it's the Civil War, that time period, and a couple of others, films. Michael Feifer, he is out of Atlanta right now. He lives there and does a lot of the cowboy genre. And so, number one, I felt he would be perfect for this conversation. Number two, he definitely has opinions about what can be used in a film and how it's being used. And I'd say he's more tech savvy on the question than most people are. Certainly folks shooting with the real weapons and using blanks. And then the next person I'm going to have is Joey Dillon, very good old friend of mine, younger than me, but old friend of mine, who is out here today and is an armorer, number 44 local, I believe it is, and prop person. And he's going to talk about what happens, how it's going. I have had him on before. I think you'll enjoy this conversation as well. I'm hoping to have, of course, I've got Kevin E. West, who's a SAG delegate. He'll be on talking about the safety parts. In addition, I might have Victor, and here we go. So with that being said, I'm going to show you something that will give the credibility that I've given to Michael, which he needs none because he has a lot of this style film. And I'm looking right here. It's a film that just came out. And by the way, you can get it on Amazon, I believe. If not, you'll correct me, Michael, when you get on. Here it is.
What you looking for?
Ain't this the ranch of Marshal Britt MacMasters?
He ain't here.
You wouldn't mind if me and my friends here had a look inside, would you?
Grandpa!
You're coming with us.
What happened?
It's your pa.
Where's Chad?
We don't know.
telegraphed to Sheridan to see if they had any activity.
Jed Blake.
You know him?
I put him away 5 years ago. I need to pick up my guide. Got a tracking job for you.
We're out here riding in the open.
Why did we come this way?
A little bit of torture first.
I'll find them. You kill them, you owe me nothing.
You trust him?
With my life. Where's Jed Blake?
Where the hell are you?
Play catch the bullet.
Let's play. Let's see who catches the bullet.
Now, the second person I'm going to bring into the loop here is, of course, Joey Dillon. I've known Joey for a long time, and he is on top of the fact that he is now a union prop and armorer. I've known him as a performer and really kind of a mentor in many ways, dealing with the firearms that we all know. So I'm just going to show you the picture here really quickly of what that looks like. This is Joey on set. I know he's worked Westworld and a plethora of other films and TV shows. He is now very gracefully transitioned into doing what he does and has an enormous knowledge and has an enormous amount of information about, all that we do in the industry. I just had to clear an audio track so we're not echoing. So with that being said, and then I'll bring Kevin E. West in just a second or two. But let's bring these guys in as a three shot. And here we are. Gentlemen, welcome to the show.
Hey.
Hello. So let's just start off, and I'm going to try as much as I can to be a moderator that can go, okay, go, if there's any particular question. But I am going to start off right off the bat and hit you, Michael, on this question you've done, and I would say that you have a pretty good fondness for Westerns, and you've done a lot of these. In your opinion, what's happening right now with firearms in films? You made a statement to me back a day or two or so ago about the fact that you're kind of you're a CGI guy. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, well, I made a Western called White Herb's Revenge back in 2011. And I've made six or so Westerns since then. But back in 2011, we had a lot of characters, we had a lot of firing, and we used blanks over the whole movie, blanks everywhere. But what I kept finding when we were using blanks is it's very time consuming on my schedules, because I make movies in 13 to 17 days. And blanks are take time. And so after that movie, CGI visual effects got less and less costly. And I found that I did some other movies where there's some gunfire going off and smoke and muzzle flashes were easy. So the next Western that I did, I said, no more blanks. Now, it wasn't a safety thing particularly. I wasn't concerned particularly because I felt that we were safe on White Earth's Revenge and nothing happened and everything was fine. It was really a time issue is why I stopped using blanks on set, simply because the characters can just be shooting all day long. No problem. We don't have to split blanks in. We don't have to yell fire in the hall. We don't have to pass out protection. And then all of those muzzle flashes smoke just done later. And so it was a time. There was a safety aspect too, of course, because blanks are, they do fire. And in Los Angeles, we utilize Westerns in California where a spark could go on the ground and cause a fire. And so I just felt it was easier to go without any blanks. And so the six or seven Westerns I've done, then we haven't fired off one blank.
Joey, can you do me a favor for the audience? I know you are probably tired of doing this now, but can we explain the process that you go through when you're working on a set? If someone says, okay, you are the armorer, if you're handing a gun to someone in a scene, can you take us from point A to point whatever that is and just kind of run that over for us?
Sure. Happy to. Generally speaking, the guns and the ammunition and the dummy ammunition are sourced from a prop house and an armory. So they start there, the dummy rounds and the blanks and everything come in special boxes. And then, of course, you got to dummy up the gun belts with dummy rounds and things like that. All of those are checked by me to make sure that they are indeed fake. And then we get to the point where we're moving on to production. Prior to production, a lot of times I'll meet with the actors and actresses to go over how they operate the gun and to handle it safely. And then also per their character, how well they should look like they should know how to use it. And then we're into the show. And then the day of the show, these guns are coming out of a lock box or a lock cart. And then I'm taking them to the first AD and to show that they are cold. If there's a lot of guns, the first AD, first assistant director, will come to my cart and look at everything and see that the weapons are cold. And then if we get to, let's say, a rehearsal for the scene, then I'll take the guns over. We'll either rehearse with a rubber gun or the real gun. We'll take that over to the actor, actress. After I've showed the AD, then AD will call it out on set that there's a cold weapons on set. And then I will show the actor or actress that they're unloaded before giving it to them. If they have to point at another actor or actress, I'm showing it to that person that they're unloaded and cold. If they have dummy rounds in them so that they appear loaded on camera. And when I say dummy rounds to the audience out there, I mean something that looks like real ammo or real bullets, even though bullets should refer to the projectile, but something looks real in the cylinder of the revolver to make it look loaded on camera. I have to first, before I even bring them out, verify that they are indeed fake. We can talk about that later. And then I show them to the first AD that he verifies it. Then I put them in the weapon and point it at the ground and I go click, 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 dry firing to show that they're fake. And I do the same for the actor, actress, and whoever they're pointing it at. So that's usually the level that goes to it. If we get to blanks, you know, then there's a few more things like checking the bore of the gun to make sure there's nothing in the bore that would be a foreign matter that would become a projectile once you put a blank behind it. If the gun's going in the dirt, blah, 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 you got to clean it out and double check for that stuff as well between takes and things like that. So that gives you some idea. Also, sometimes, like on a Netflix show, you might have a safety advisor that's constantly looking over your shoulder. In California, you have fire safety officers that actually in the morning of want to see what you're doing, what blank loads you're using, what guns are out. And then also the prop master generally is involved in getting the guns, the ammo, the blanks, the dummy rounds and things like that as well. So there's a level of responsibility that he has to get the right equipment and besides just the armory and the prop house providing safe equipment.
Let me ask you a question. When you say safety person on set, is that something that you see in both union and non-union?
That one I was mainly saw in some streaming companies prefer to have that as an extra layer. So it's sort of rare to have a safety advisor and that person, and I don't say this negatively, but sticks his nose into every department's business, stunts, myself, pyro, you know, I'm sorry, special effects, things like that, just to get a sense. And he or she doesn't necessarily need to be an expert at everything, but I think they're a good gauge of character and people. He asked me questions and liked to see how I reacted and talked about what I was doing. And I think at some point he realized I didn't know what I was doing. And he watched some of our rehearsals. Now, sometimes you don't get them in the beginning of the show. Maybe it's a day player or a stunt person and you're taking them away from set on the day to explain what they're doing, because it could be a very simple gun comes out, you know, and shoots and it's just one shot. And generally they have knowledge of that or can be trained pretty quickly. A lot of people are pretty competent to do that quickly, but it's up to me. If I think they're not, then maybe say, well, maybe they just don't shoot the blank for this scene because it's too much background people running by and things like that.
Right. Michael, on your sets, do you have, I guess yourself, have any sort of protocol, even if the guns are not real, that your crew puts people through? And let me ask you from a director's standpoint, do you have them trained on how to hold it so it's correct and looks right? Is that something that you do?
Well, first of all, let me say also, I'm a producer on all my films too. So everything, all liability is on me. I try to only hire in these Westerns as much as possible people who have Western background or Western experience. For instance, Catch the Bolt you saw there, every actor is a Western actor who rides horses first, who's been in movies with guns before, and they know the safety. But let me say this, Will, it's really important. I think Joey would agree with me too. There's a reasonable expectation we have of people behaving themselves, being responsible. You know, if I'm walking across the street in a crosswalk and there's somebody in a car stopped, I have a reasonable expectation that that person is not going to step on the gas and run me over. In every industry, whether it's the steel industry, whether it's the power industry, whether it's retail, we all have a reasonable expectation that people are going to behave themselves and not do stupid things. Although people do dumb things on movie sets. For a live bullet to be in a gun is completely criminal and completely unreasonable. And with all the precautions we take, it's still, if somebody is a criminal and wants to do something, they can do it, you know? Absolutely. So we take, you know, so on my set, yeah, we have the armor, we check it, and the AD checks it. The actors all know, I always try to make sure the actors, you know, I myself as a producer will tell the actors, listen, don't point the gun at anybody. When you get a gun, check it yourself. Always check it yourself. You know, I think all my actors do that. You know, Drew Waters, who starred in two of my Westerns, you know, he's a guy who understands guns. He understands horses. And I always see him pull out his gun, he'll fire it seven times into the ground, make sure it's empty. You know, we're always making sure just in case there is a live bullet. But the fact that we're talking about this right now, because, you know, I mean, there's 20,000 Westerns have been made without a problem. We're talking about this now because one person, I believe, is a criminal if that person actually put a live bullet in that gun and left that gun for people to take. There's other issues that occurred along the line, handing a gun over that without checking it, somebody else taking a gun and not checking it, or producers knowing there's a problem with that person. But we have a reasonable expectation to believe that people are going to, you know, if we're doing a scene with an axe and it's a real axe, you know, we don't expect somebody to run over and slam them in the back with the axe, you know.
I think your point is very frustrating,
this whole situation for me, I believe, you know?
Yeah, no, and I agree with you. And this is the thing I keep having the conversation with, because I've got friends all over the place that are, whether they're weapons people or they're movie people like you two, that literally are saying, but why didn't they treat the gun like it was a real gun? And I keep saying the same thing is that, you know, an actor's job is to get up in front of the camera and do what the director has asked them to do. No offense, but in the middle of a scene that we're shooting, if I'm your actor and I come up to you, Michael, and go, hey, by the way, I think this other actor should do this and do that. Well, you'd probably tell me a lot of things. One of them would be get off my set. The point is that an actor is handed the weapon and with the assumption, like you said, that someone like Joey is going to clear it. And by the way, Joey, when you say the word cold, can you just really quickly add to what we just said and tell me what cold means for the audience?
Sure. Cold means nothing in it that's going to go off. I mean, to put it sort of, you know, I don't know.
Easy.
So I would look at it after clearing a gun with dummy rounds, again, a fake bullet in it, I could still look at that gun and say that it's cold. But I would still speak to people with dummy rounds, and then that would make them go, oh, and we should check that. You know what I mean? Or when I give it to the actor, I'll go through it so that they don't look at it and go, wait, I thought you said it was cold. So I'll explain that what these are before I do that with the actor. But yeah, cold is not going to go off. Hot means it's going to go off.
Okay. And again, I just want to clarify that when people are right now telling me and leaving comments like you shouldn't point it at someone and you shouldn't do, these are all things, and please tell me if you agree, some of the things that are being said about this, like how did a live round in there get in there? These are things that you're asked or you're stating from people who use guns for ranges and self-protection. In the movie industry, we would use, in a lot of cases, especially Westerns, real guns because, I don't, to my knowledge, the replicas aren't quite, you know, they don't look official. And they can be modified, but I just want to be clear about pointing it into the camera lens or someone. Michael, please.
Well, we do ask actors to point guns at camera or slightly off camera, so it's, there might be a crew member there, or at another actor. I mean, if I'm doing an over-the-shoulder shot of someone holding a gun, right? Someone's holding a gun, I'm doing an over-the-shoulder shot, I need to see that gun pointing at that other actor.
Right.
It's just, I mean, you can't have a shootout without it, you know? But we've cleared the gun. The gun is safe. The gun is just as dangerous as a hammer at that point, yeah. You know? But we have a reasonable expectation that nobody brought a live bullet to set and nobody put a live bullet in the gun, you know? And that, and 20,000, 30,000 Westerns, you know, it hasn't happened until now. Brandon Lee, it happened. I mean, it does.
Yeah.
Clearly it's happened, but it's just very frustrating to hear this dialogue that goes on from people that are on sets. Yes, we use real guns because they do look better. I'd rather not use real guns, but I've been talked out of it multiple times because, you know, people are convinced the real ones don't look as good because we do close-ups and the metal reflects a certain way.
Yeah.
But the other thing is we do have to point it. You do have to point it at the camera or the, you know, the DPs behind the camera, but there shouldn't be anything wrong with it. It's the same thing as pointing a hammer at somebody or pointing a phone at somebody. That gun is just a block of metal at that point. Absolutely. And it's been checked, so it's actually safer.
Joey, thoughts on that at all?
Well, Michael said a couple times, one thing that I will agree with. I agree with a lot of things, but I'm saying one thing I want to bring up as well, which is I wish we could just stop talking about this because it doesn't mean anything for anybody. It just means some stuff got seriously screwed up. It doesn't happen on every other movie set because we have safety protocols. We don't need new safety protocols. We don't have to stop pointing guns at people because we've done so safely for ages. We would all like to just move on. The only reason we're having this conversation is because other people who don't know exactly what they're talking about are having conversations. And so we're like, wait a minute, it's time to defend our profession a little. If you're going to start giving those people a microphone, then we need to get near a microphone. Cause I'd rather have not gotten on news things or talked about any of this out of just, I'm crushed for everybody involved. Even the people that were responsible, my heart breaks for them because nobody maliciously did this. Even if they were criminally negligent, it's the worst day of their life and they'll probably never fully recover from this.
Right.
So the hate should stop about for everybody. Yeah. You're angry. And then, you know, I'm on the same opinion that an actor and actress should be shown it's empty and cold. And if they're not, they should demand it and they should speak up a little more about that, but they should also have complete confidence because if I have to tell an actor or an actress, you need to double check that I didn't just give you a gun with real bullets in it. They're going to say, well, then what are you doing here?
Yeah.
And I'll bring up another analogy, which is to say you put an actor in a car and he drives towards camera and he's supposed to just slowly come to a stop. And then something happens, the front wheel falls off and it veers to the right and kills a crew member. Is he responsible or was he supposed to go around with a lug wrench and check all the lug nuts? He was like, no, the picture cards gave me a car and said, drive it. It's that department. So whoever's in charge of weapons, you need to look that direction. I can't speak to exactly what happened because I wasn't there, but there's a department responsible for something. And if whoever's putting that crew together holds some responsibility, but not unfortunately, Alec. And I think it's also important to say that it depends on the size and budget of the film, but on a lot of the stuff that I've been working on, we're literally trying to hide 50 to 75 people between the fourth wall, because you got three or four cameras facing different, all one direction, and you've got a bunch of people coming down the street with guns, and you got to have all those people somewhere where they're standing. They're all behind camera, and the guns are just panning past back and forth. Of course, they're pointing at crew members.
Yeah.
You know?
And I totally agree with you. And one of the things that I want to say, and we can bring this up and I take a teeny weeny break and then bring in Kevin E. West, but the fact of the matter is that I kind of think, and there's, I mean, I don't want to say that there's a positive thing coming out of this, but I will say that there is a moment here that is better than what we normally get with some of the gun stuff that happens, whether it's a school shooting or whatever, is that I think this is a good chance for us to talk about safety and education as opposed to, hey, someone's got a gun and they shouldn't have it. Just because I think, again, this has been spotlighted that things were done wrong and guns were handled wrong and misconceptions. And so I'm glad you gentlemen have come on to do this. So I'm going to take a teeny weeny break if you guys have a minute or two and then come back in with Kevin E. West. Do you mind? Good. Appreciate it. I'm going to find the slate here. Here it is. So I want to point out someone here in LA that I work with that actually provides a lot of this type of stuff for movies, David Hill for Movie Rentals. And you can go there to the site for movierentals.com. He has picture cars, uniforms, props, stuff like that. And in most cases, if someone needs to have an armorer or someone that handles that type of prop, that person can be hired as well. I just want to bring this up because David is a good guy and he's doing everything he can to make sure that everything is safe as well. I had a conversation with him at one point today and he basically said the same thing, which is, you know, this is a very sad moment and we all need to make sure that we're looking and understanding the safety parts of this. With that being said, I'm going to attempt to, let me just check one thing because I had one of my people, I got Sal's message on Instagram saying, oh, okay. All right, good. So I'm going to go to a four shot here. I'm going to try this. Actually, it's a five shot and see what happens. Kevin is there. Kevin, I'm going to let me change some stuff on you and put you in green screen. Standby, Kevin E. West, blue screen, and you get a thing like me. And I'm going to adjust this and do that and bring you
up. That's way better.
Yeah, thanks. Let me bring you up here like this. There you go. Kevin E. West, of course, and I know Kevin from being on my show acting-wise, but Kevin is also a SAG-AFTRA delegate. And I wanted Kevin on and you guys all to – let's just throw some things around, and hopefully Victor will join us. I know he said that he was supposed to come in at a certain time. And so anyway, with that being said, Kevin, you've been hearing all what we've said, right?
Absolutely.
Do you want to start off with any sort of like thoughts as a union delegate about maybe what happened and maybe going forward or anything? Throw us something.
Well, I probably should at least give the audience some a little bit of background along with Michael and Joey. First of all, Michael, I knew Jay Pickett. That's item number one. Yeah, I know. I'm also a Tennessee boy who rides horses and grew up around guns. And so, Will, to your point, I'm also somebody who doesn't currently own one. I have. But every single thing, obviously, that Michael and Joey have said is absolutely correct. You know, the union simply has a policy of the fact that there's supposed to be somebody on a set who is in charge of the department, whatever that department may be, as Joey said. Sometimes it's this, sometimes it's that. But since I've spent half of my career doing episodic dramas and involving guns, I've had them shot around me, shot near me, inclusive of them being myself. The truth of the matter is there is a protocol. You expect that protocol to be followed. Now, personally, and Michael kind of touched on this and Joey sort of touched on it, I personally would not let somebody hand me an actual gun that's going to be a prop that is, I know, a real gun and just walk away. I would still ask them to sort of just verbally go through the protocol or depending on what type of gun it is or a Western gun, show me the chamber as to whether or not it is got a modification in it for blanks. Or I mean, I would ask that of somebody. If it's supposed to be completely empty, then just, you know, show me that the chamber is clear. That's something that I would naturally do. Now, I know that I'm somebody who is a little more comfortable around guns than maybe a good percentage of actors are. So I would never just let somebody walk off, even though, yes, Michael is correct. We have a reasonable expectation that this should be something that's we don't have to concern ourselves with. That's what someone's job is. But nonetheless, I do it just for myself because and I also agree with you, Will, 1,000%. This is about safety. Joey, you know, made the comment criminally negligible. I think you're probably going to see that come up in this particular situation. I do. Part of that's the culture we're in today. But I also am going to agree with you guys that, and I'm going to use, Michael used a good example of walking across the street. I'm going to use mothers against drunk drivers. Whereas the whole situation with alcohol and driving drunk happened because thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people were being killed by drunk drivers. This is one incident. It is horrific. It is tragic. It is all of those things. And yes, you know, you can say that it's supposed to be a 10 to 15 degree angle off, and based on your lens, it will still look like it's being pointed at. We can go over and over all those things from both sides of the camera. It is an awful story, and all of what is surrounding it. It's not the same as John Eric Hexum, but it has elements of it. It's not the same as Brandon Lee. It has elements of it. You know, the fact that the crew had walked off in the morning, the fact that the gun had been used for target practice earlier that day, all of those things we would know about none of this if somebody would have simply properly cleared the gun beforehand.
Right.
It simply wasn't done. I could never in my own conscience, personally as an actor, I could never have held a gun up, pointing it even remotely in someone's direction, which you have to do to get the shot. So anyone trying to cover that angle is being a little bit ridiculous because that's how you get that shot. But I would have naturally asked the person to check the gun with me while I was standing there. But
right.
It's horrific. But I agree with everything they've said, obviously, for a number of reasons.
Okay. And so I just, again, I want to emphasize the fact that I think we all agree in the case that in what we do, that safety, because each situation can be different. Different angle, different situation, different type of gun, whatever it may be. And that I just want to make clear that we are definitely trying to enlighten people watching this about what we do with film, TV, theater, whatever the case may be, when it comes to weapons and, you know, different things like stunts. That's why right now on the center screen, Victor. Victor is a friend, and he has also been on the show several times. He has a Monday segment that he wasn't able to do today, talking about the business of show business. And he is a director and also martial artist and deals with that, too. So I know that you just kind of came into the fold here, Victor, so I'm letting you listen to a little bit of this. So, you know, by all means, gentlemen, one little rule of all this is that I'm going to try to be an effective moderator. I'm not going to keep you all day. I want to talk a little bit about a couple of things, but if you have a something you want to chime in, just sort of, you know, push your way into it, and I'll do my best to acknowledge you.
I just want to chime in on something,
yeah,
Will.
Please.
I just want, Kevin, that was great. Thank you. I just want to say that I only said there's a reasonable expectation that there wouldn't be a live bullet on set, but I always expect people to behave improperly with the guns, which is why we're ultra safe with the guns. But a live bullet is a whole nother thing. That is completely insane.
Yeah, and I want to add into that something that this is another reason why I come to this thing with just a little bit more knowledge than most of the people is because I have a company called the Reenactors Group, and we have over 2,000 reenactors in all periods of time. World War I, World War II, Cowboy, Mountain Men, Civil War, Revolution, Rev War, and all of these people. I just want to say this for the general public to understand that not a single one of those people, to my knowledge, use fake guns. They use real guns. They use black powder. They use, you know, historical firearms. And I have conversations literally every day and can tell you about a situation that happened 2.5 years ago, I think it was, in Tombstone, where one of the reenactors felt that, well, you know, I have my rights and I can carry my ammo. And I said, no, that's not a reenactment. That's a crime scene. And here we are. The point is that this is going to change a lot of things, not just how we are on set, but we might be seeing a lot of romantic comedies, guys. Michael, get writing. Because this will definitely change things across the board, in my opinion. Victor, any thoughts about throwing into any of this at this point?
Well, first of all, gentlemen, it's a pleasure to meet you all. And, well, thank you for having me. To me, that unfortunate event was really, really surprising. I think that, yeah, there are so many things which we could discuss. Sometimes I feel like, you know, there's a difference between a professional holding the gun versus an actor who had a two-day workshop. And even that Mr. Baldwin had some long career in Hollywood, it still doesn't mean that he's a professional with the gun. So how is he pointing? And maybe he got just a little bit pissed off and did something silly. I think that all the things that they should be studied well, and we should treat a life as a value. And, you know, if people are guilty, they should be responsible, no matter what kind of power is your family name holding in the industry or in the city.
Sure.
And In my case, I always have professionals from that industry or from that sphere on my set. Like if I have to deal with guns, I would have some representatives of the military or of the police force who actually know what they're doing. I know, like, you know, back in Eastern Europe, we as young men, we all go through these practices. So we know about guns a little bit more than young people here. But nevertheless, the professional has to be here, like the medical has to be here. Martial arts, like that's what I do. That's my main background. I know that a lot of actors, they take workshops and then they call themselves masters. It's funny, right? But it's not the safest thing to do. And you know, I'm glad that when they filmed the little funny series Cobra Kai, nobody got hurt, but there were no professionals. Neither two of those main actors, right? Mr. Zapka and then the guy playing Daniel or the kids, they were amateurs. So I'm happy nobody got hurt. But if that's my project, which I'm directing, I would definitely have professionals who know what they're doing, how to hit, how to kick, how to hold it, when to hold it. That's what we do, you know, and you cannot get it on the workshop. So that's probably my little chip in, as you called it.
Sure, sure. So,
well, let me say also, you know, as a producer and a director, and any of you guys, I think Joey's a perfect example. If we have to, we're working with people. It's a people business. We're working with people 12 hours a day. People are fallible. People in the movie business, they say things that they don't actually do. They fake their resumes. They whatever. They're big personalities. We have to evaluate people. For instance, if Joey is, you know, training an actor, giving it out, and he sees that an actor is not behaving themselves, is not safe, is not, he's going to go to the producer and say, I don't trust this person. I don't think this person's safe. And the producer is going to say, well, should we keep the person on? Should we not? Or how can we make sure? And I think in this situation too, there's a lot of issue where they knew that this person wasn't safe. There was a previous incident a week before,
right,
with a gun. I don't know if it was a live bullet again or a blank, you guys might know better, but production, I as a producer, and I'm liable. I mean, this business that I have is my wife and I and my son. That's a family business. I have to evaluate human beings and decide whether or not they're responsible enough to be on my set. I've fired people before because I don't think they're responsible on my set. I've fired a grip before who doesn't set the stands correctly and things are falling or doesn't put enough sandbags. And so we have to also evaluate the crew members. And this was a situation too where I think they had plenty of time to evaluate whether this person should be in armor and should be on set. That was missed, sadly. I think that was another mistake there.
Kevin, can I ask you a question from a union standpoint? What I heard was that people walked off and they didn't have union people to fill some of the crew. Is that something that the union would say, then you better halt production until you figure out who, or do you just go, hey, let's go to Ace Hardware and find an expert? I mean, really?
No, they can't. I mean, the SAG-AFTRA can't do that because the crew that walked off was IATSE. Oh, and sure. The reality is this is in New Mexico. And, you know, whether you like it or not, the production had a right to refill that crew, which they did with non-union crew members.
Does that mean it's right? Is it right to work state?
Well, IATSE allows their members to work union, non-union. So... but they were 50 miles from what you might call producer's base. Michael and Joey both know this conversation well. I think some of this would be related perhaps either to money. I do know that there were reports. I want to make sure I say there were reports that Ms. Hutchins had tried to plead with the union crew to not walk, but there were enough complaints about certain things, even related to safety per your point, Will, about this before they walked. And again, you know, taking the unfortunate phraseology of the show must go on, they simply replaced them because there's certainly enough production there, just like Baton Rouge or just like Hawaii, where they can, or Portland, they can populate people who have a certain degree of experience. And, you know, Michael's again 1,000% correct. By the way, we could do a romantic comedy, Michael, with a horse, but that's a different subject.
I've
done it. In any form of hiring, and Will, you know that I've been an employer in my life, you do take a reasonable expectation that the person you're hiring for position for which they have a resume has a base understanding of how to do this. And it's as Victor said, it's not necessarily the same as, because I agree with him. Again, I happen to be somebody who is comfortable with and familiar with guns. That is not most actors.
No.
In all sorts of places, it's not. But you take a reasonable expectation, even if it's a non-union crew, that they at least have a clue. And the reports, which I believe have been fairly confirmed, that this gun that was actually used and put in Mr. Baldwin's hand had been used for target practice earlier that day. And that's supposedly right now a confirmed report. And so, unfortunately, Joey is correct. I mean, I feel for Joey's profession because, as it's been stated, 99.99999% for the last 30 years, this has not been something that has to become a thing. And this is just a level of irresponsibility and idiocy that it's very, very hard to fathom for me. It's very hard.
Gentlemen, I'm going to ask you a question, and then I'm going to ask for really quick closing comments. I'm going to ask everybody to answer the same question, starting with Joey, is that how do you think, either negative or positive, that this has affected you going to work tomorrow? How is this going to affect the industry? Joey, thoughts?
Joey, I don't see any positives right now. If I had to just grab one, out of the universe, I would say a big problem in this industry, as Michael said, is people fake their resumes or say, I know how to ride a horse, and they don't. And so actresses, stunt people come up to me, they don't want to ask a stupid question about the gun or the scene. And I have to, I do my best to pull dumb questions out of them, but I'm not always good enough at getting it out of them, but I do give them the opportunity, and I say, we can do a new take anytime you want to raise your hand and stop something for safety because you're not comfortable, you don't understand, stop production. I know there's 100 people staring at you and you're afraid, but stop it for the sake of safety or knowing what's going on. Hopefully we don't get to the middle of the scene before they do that, because I say, do you have any questions about what I'm asking you to do? You've said you've understand this, you've shot guns. And I obviously do it with them cold and try to make sure they know what they're doing. But just, I hope it gives actors and actresses and people maybe a little fear to actually start asking more questions and be bolder about their ignorance, because there's nothing wrong with being ignorant. You know, even in my profession, I work with stuff, and I'm not afraid to ask the armory, what about this part on this gun? I've not encountered that before. I'm not afraid of looking stupid, because I'll make myself the expert by asking all the questions. And the actors and actresses should say, show me it's unloaded, if I have not already provided that. I am glad that they trust me. But in all the stuff that's going on, even with anything else that they're doing, there's a lot of times people are afraid they won't get work again if they ask a stupid question. And you know what? Maybe this will promote them to just start saying, no, I want to see it now.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I think you brought up a very, very valid point that I normally talk when I do film festival live. I, of course, talk to the film festival creators, directors, producers, and actors. And the thing I tell actors all the time is that do not lie on your resume. I know a story. Judith Bellay, she used to do all of Jodie Foster's stuff when I was working in the 80s, late 80s. And there was a girl that was on a set for a commercial we're doing, said, I didn't ride a horse. She literally broke both legs. She had no idea what she was doing. Not only, by the way, are you costing the production a shitload of money, but you're also going to screw yourself in the future for any kind of work. And there are so many variables. And obviously, in this case, you can be talking about a weapon. Victor, what's your takeaway on what maybe the industry and what might happen?
So I think that there are two different worlds in the industry. It's business, which a slight piece of it is independent production, but business and then the studios. The studios, to me, it's bureaucracy, and they don't care about details, such as you gentlemen mentioned resumes. I never hire people based on the resume. Always either someone recommends them, or I check their past, or we have a conversation. I never want to see the resume. I know it could be faked, and I would rather hire a military professional than an actor, based on, you know, riding a horse. Now, unions, I think, I don't know if you gentlemen watched a TV movie, American Factory, about the unions. I think that the unions should either remodel themselves or die, because they are the thing which make the industry inefficient. People try to get into the union, and it doesn't mean right now that they are really professional. The unions are filled with people, and the most of them are not really good. But they try to get in to be protected and to get the job and everything. So that's understandable. Everybody's trying to fight for a piece of bread. But on the other hand, it's already 21st century, and the unions is the 19th probably. So we have to remodel that part and to make the union the representation of high quality. You cannot get into the union unless you, you know, and you represent the quality on set, not just time limitation before lunch, after lunch, and you have to have a silverware or blah, blah, blah. And each union is different. Like, I had writers trying to complain based on SAG regulations. I'm like, you are a writer. We are not WGA projects. So it doesn't work like this. It's all very separated. And, you know, if you have guns which have to be shot, probably need someone from that specific, you know, union, not from SAG or not from DGA or not from WGA, because it's a very different space, right. You know, specialization. So I think that with some more events in the industry, including all this not necessary vaccination mandate, I think something should change, because people need to work. And this is business, first of all. It's not just art for art. Like, we've done 3 shows, we're working 2 feature films. I would never allow myself to be inefficient business-wise, time-wise, and of course, life-wise. Yeah. And in this case, yeah.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, one of the things I've been sort of harping on is that when I started in 1981 or 2, is that it used to be, and Kevin, you're next, so you can sort of address this as well, but it used to be a far cry, different story to get into the union. And now I just tell people, why don't you just go create a web series? But I know, Kevin, you can clear this up, because Kevin is, he's a SAG-AFTRA delegate. So it's a little easier now. Kevin, what's your thought on the take?
Well, to go back to the original question, I think that this, again, I feel for Joey and Michael, and I think that there'll be a, like there commonly is in this country, a very stark, quick reaction that I think will ease over time. And my hope, obviously, is that, to Victor's point, in areas like this, that the eventual end will be that for a few dollars more, which I'm pretty sure was a bad spaghetti Western, unless I'm not remembering it correctly, pardon the pun, that for a few dollars more, we will cease the practice of shortcutting, whether they're union or not, Victor, shortcutting the concept for a few dollars on something like armory and safety. Mm-hmm. That's my hope long-term, because this can't even, to me, this can't even come close to ever happening again, and it should never come close to ever happening again. As far as the union's concerned, you could make arguments, I believe, for the last 30 or 40 years, and we could have a union conversation all day long and twice on Sundays about ultimately, it's really about management abusing labor, but within just the labor concept, which is what Victor said, the benchmark for what you would be perceived as or defined as in terms of a degree of expertise based on simply holding a union card, whether that is DGA, WGA, SAG-AFTRA, or IATSE, unfortunately, really does come down to your real life actual resume and what you have done. Right. Because, yes, you could just go get 3 vouchers now by sitting on a set literally as breathing furniture and having donuts and get your SAG after card. And with all respect, yeah, I mean, I've said it for years, and it does. I got tons of friends that do background. That's not my point. My point is that you can learn a certain amount of things from sitting in the dugout at a baseball game, but you're only going to learn other things by actually stepping in the box or having a ball hit at you at third base. So there is a real world practicality to all of those things and all of the unions. And it has become something where we don't make it as much as a professional leap to work your way to there as much as it is just the ability to say that I'm in the club and therefore I should be garnered a certain thing. Yes, that is. And to Victor's point, a lot of that actually is because of just simply pure money.
Yeah. And I just want to throw in, and then we'll go to Michael finally, is that, you know, I agree that I think that a takeaway from all of this could be that shortcutting And, you know, lack of money is one of the reasons why we don't necessarily get people who are totally qualified to be doing their jobs that they're doing. Because I've been, and I'm not talking about just here in the United States, but we can't really say much about outside the States. Because when I was in Brazil or Mumbai, they don't even, like, let's do a saddle pull. And they're like, let's get a wheel. What are we going to do? I'm like, well, you need a harness. And they're like, let's just get a garbage can. Point is that we going forward, I would just say to you gentlemen, everybody in this conversation and anybody listening, it is our duty, if we have a job on set, whether it's actor, producer, director, stunts, armorer, whatever you happen to be doing, that you follow through that little extra step, because going forward, I think that we'll be under a lot of scrutiny. Michael, what's your thought and takeaway?
Well, I think that unfortunately, you're Kevin's called it idiocy. You're not going to be able to stop people who are idiots, people who are criminals. Just like driving, we have all sorts of parameters and restrictions with driving, with speed limits, and yet still somebody drives like a maniac, crashes, and causes people to die or drinks alcohol. So what I think has to happen is people have to learn a lesson from this. I think one of the most important lessons to learn is that you have to evaluate who you hire, who you put on your movie, who's a part of your crew, because those people, I always say, I mean, I've produced 120 movies. I'm only as good as my crew. That's it. My crew backs me up. So you have to evaluate. And the moment you see somebody who's not behaving correctly or isn't prepared or doesn't really know it, you have to be involved. As I make my movies, I'm the producer and the director. Before I was directing movies, I was actually ADing and live producing my movies because I wanted to know what everybody was doing. I needed to see how they behaved and how they worked on set. So I think something that can be learned from this is if you're a producer, if you're somebody who is an executive, because from what I understand, these crew members were complaining about safety and apparently nothing was being done. So as an executive, as a producer, as a line producer, production manager, coordinator, and a key in a department, you have to be you can't be afraid to step up and say, I think there's a problem with this crew member, or this person isn't qualified to be where they are. You know, a lot of times people don't want to step on other people's toes, but making movies is inherently dangerous.
Yeah.
You know, and we have to keep everybody safe. And to me, the best way to keep people safe is to really recognize that we're all working together, and you need people who really care and who are really competent and who are really what I call it hypervigilance. They're hypervigilant on set. When I'm directing, I'll say action, but then I'll see somebody carrying a C-stand that's just about to hit somebody in the head. And I'll be like, whoa, you know, stop. Like, it's just an overall hypervigilance that I think we need on set. And I think that if they were hypervigilant and recognize that this person probably wasn't qualified, had made a mistake previously, some other issues, they wouldn't have gotten to this point, unfortunately. And it's sad. It gives me goosebumps to think about. It's very upsetting.
Gentlemen, I want to thank you all for coming on and doing this live stream. I think it's just one of the other jobs that we have is in our industry is educating people about what we do and what we don't do. Because, you know, in this day and age, whatever you want to call it, you can call it fake news. You can call it, you know, no one's watching out for me, whatever. You can call it one-sided. I think it's important for all of us. And I think that I know this group of people, by the way, and I know a lot about this group. And I will say that there are two sides of the story here being represented, and there's only two sides. And you all have done a great job in helping really convey the safety and what we do properly and what we should consider doing going forward in the future. Is there any last short comment that anybody wants to make? Bingo. That was your time.
I could keep going on and on. I'm sure we all could.
Oh, yeah, you can go on and on. I know you can. And I will probably knock on your doors again. I'll see you, Victor, on Monday. And the rest of you, you know I'll see you very soon. I really appreciate it again. I'm going to go to a single shot. Do not leave. I want to say goodbye to you all. But hang tight. Here we go. I'm going to go to my single right about now. Hang tight. All right, everybody. Thank you for coming on the show. I really want you to understand that why we did this was not to give our opinions necessarily on what has happened, because things are still evolving and unveiling. And the bottom line is that we want you to understand that what we do, we're very passionate in doing. And that is the most important thing you need to understand, because with passion comes understanding that you need to be able to share to people that you are, you know, that you do what you do every day and you wake up early because of that. So with that being said, I want to thank everybody else out there. Thank them all. Yep. Really appreciate it. Yep. My news source in Australia, Alan, he's awesome. And this is all the way, by the way, it's on about 300 or 400 different news companies have been posted this. And hopefully we're getting a good audience, because our voices and our experience in this matter is extremely important right now. So I thank everybody watching. Please, by all means, if you want to leave a comment or ask any questions to any one of these people, you can go to filmfestivallive.com. You can go to my channel, which is Actor Will Roberts. You can go to my Instagram. But by all means, do not leave me conspiracy theories and you think this and you think that and this person's that and this person's that. I will block you immediately, because this is a moment for us to do kumbaya, my lord, and not to do what some people are doing with this situation and putting it left, right, in between. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week. I really appreciate your time. And here goes the exit music.